We're going to get started with some worship. So if you want to bow your hearts before the Lord, and we will ask him to bless this time. Amen. Amen. God, we thank you so much for your goodness in our lives, Lord. Thank you for this place and the warmth in this building. God, I just pray that you would bless this time. We open our hearts up to you, Father, and just ask that you'd be glorified in all that we do. Lord, we love you so much. It's in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. All right. Well, why don't we all stand, because while I sit, I heard one person laugh. Is that what kind of night it's going to be? One person laugh. Come on. Wow. Well, if you're tuning in online, I promise you we are all weirdos for Jesus.
Amen.
So we can be weird for Jesus, right? No other kind of weirdo stuff. Whack. This is my friend over here. Whack. W-A-C is his initials. And he's whacked out for Jesus. Wade Allen Clark. All right, enough of that.
Like never before. Oh.
All right. What a blessing it is to worship His name, as that song says. Amen. This is a song I'm pretty sure most people know. If you don't, just listen one time, and I promise you'll get the words of this song. Promise. Here we go.
Thank you.
wonder, awestruck wonder, at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings.
All right, so I want to give a few things away tonight. So I got a couple really cool things. Who's never been here before? Who's their very first time here? Oh, my gosh. He's still lying after all this time, David is. Man, Lord help this guy. All right, Zach and your little buddy, come on up here. You get these little lights. Yeah. There you go. Thank you. This is my bodyguard, so don't mess with me. Yeah. All right. Amen. Okay. So let's see. Who's been here the longest? Oh, yeah. Never mind. Let's do another question. No, I'm kidding. He won't want one of these. You got one of these keychains? You want one, Butch? Who doesn't have one of these? I saw Matt's hand go up. He beat TJ to the punch. All right, I got this cool bag right here. Okay, these are new. Somebody donated these, but you can carry, you know, your Bible in it and look cool. See how cool I look?
Yeah.
All right, yeah. You better say yes. But anyway, all right, so... who can tell me what chapter we're going to start today? Dylan. Nope. Jacob. Yes, sir. All right. Here. You have lots of kids, so I'll give you both of them.
Yeah.
All right. See, it pays off to study your Bible. Next week, I'm going to have $500 gift cards to... I'm kidding. Oh, wait. I forgot. I got this black bag thing. You got these little black man purses. All right, so let's see here. All right, let me see. Here's a question. What does redemption mean? Nobody raised their hand. Oh, go ahead, brother. Yeah, okay. Well, close. Yeah, here. Here, you get, at least you raised your hand and tried. Yeah. Yeah. So redeemed, bought, you know, payment of a price. Jesus paid the price. And so, what was the price that Jesus paid? This is just a question for all of us. We should know. Go ahead, Dave. Right. Yeah. I mean, that's his blood. Yes. That's right there. So, that shouldn't be a trivia question. That should be something that we all know, right? If you're born again tonight, raise your hand. If you're saved, raise your hand. So it's important that we know what that means, right? Maybe there are some folks in the room tonight that aren't saved, and that's okay. I am so stinking glad you're here. You're what matters. The rest of these people don't matter, by the way. Okay? So, no, you all matter. But if you don't know Jesus tonight, please don't leave this building without grabbing a hold of somebody and saying, hey, could you just pray that prayer with me? It really is a prayer. And we're going to look at what believing in God looks like tonight. It's in the text. It's all throughout the book of Romans. But we are in chapter 4. We finished up chapter 3 last week. Next week, I won't be here. So my friend Andrew, who plays the drums at church, is going to be teaching. And he's got somebody leading worship a friend of his, so I'm not responsible for whatever it sounds like, if it's bad, no, I'm kidding. But he's a blessing. He's been in ministry a long time, and he's got quite a testimony. So please come and hear what the Lord has to say through him. But before we get started, I got to share this. This is a prayer request, and you can take this and pray on it later, but it just really bugged me. So I was looking through Facebook because my wife says I spend a lot of time on Facebook. I was looking through Facebook, and I saw the picture of Grants Pass, city of Grants Pass, the big old Christmas tree downtown, those of you who are familiar with that, that's down there every year. And they have this cool night where they light it all up, you know, downtown Grants Pass Christmas tree lighting event. Well, this year, they changed the name from Christmas tree to holiday tree. And I thought, oh my gosh, give me a break. I mean, come on, right? It's, you know, there's so many things going on in our town, and you know, I'm certainly glad I'm not the person in charge of all those. My hat's off to all the people in office. We pray for them. God bless them. But I'm glad it's not me. There'd be a bunch of upset people in the community. But anyway, I just thought, you know what? That's not cool. And so I'm not going to stand up here and say anything bad about the city. Obviously not. You know, those folks need Jesus just like we do. But pray for that, you know? And some folks might say, that's not really a big deal. But yeah, it is. It's just, it's a picture of where we're headed. When, come on, a Christmas tree, you got to change the name to holiday tree so everybody can participate and we don't want to offend anybody. For crying out loud, if a Christmas tree offends you, I'm sorry, get over it. Like, big deal. You know what I mean? What are they going to do next? Ban red shoestrings because it offends too many people? It's like, come on. So my prayer is that our city leaders would be led by God. That's what we need. We need God-fearing men and women who will stand up for what's right. And that's really what the Lord pressed upon my heart, because it's like, God, I don't even know what to pray for these people. I just want to do not nice things. Well, we all know that's not the right answer. But God said, they're lost. Pray for their salvation. Pray for those people at that level who make those decisions, or wherever those decisions, pray for those people. So I just want to throw that out there. Let's pray for the city, you know, and keep that in your prayer, that God would continue to be the center, not just Christmas, but of everything we do, right? Seems like more and more he's getting just pushed further out. It was the school systems, and now it's, you know, it's all this just, it's mind-boggling. You start to read and look into the news and have, you know, the quarter of the news that is true. But the stuff that's acceptable now, it's just crazy. It's crazy. They have litter boxes. This isn't a joke. In the high school men's bathroom. What in the world, dude? Like, yeah. Meow. I mean, I don't know. Like, it's just the way of this society is horrible. What in the world, right? And some people say, well, you shouldn't be shocked. I'm sorry, but when I heard about that, I was shocked. If I walked into the bathroom and used a restroom and there's a litter box, I'm walking out the door. I'm good. Right? All right, I'll tell you a funny story. I was not in the bathroom, no. I do not have a litter box in my bathroom. My wife would not allow that. Anyways, I was on a missions trip in 2010. I worked for Calvary Chapel, Visalia, in the Central Valley, San Joaquin Valley, Visalia. Anybody that knows where that's at, you're really a cool person. But anyway, I went on a missions trip to Thailand. And we laid over in Osaka, Japan, right? And I'm in this airport, and you're jet lagged. I mean, we've already traveled a long distance, and It was my first time flying that far. And anyways, we're in the airport of Japan, and Japan, they're on the cutting edge of technology. All their hand warmers are like robots in the bathroom, and all these lights come on. I'm like, you go to the restroom and you stand up and the toilet bowl spins around on its own and this little brush comes out to clean the toilet bowl. Yeah, it was a trip. So I'm in the bathroom using the urinal, minding my own business, and I hear a female voice. I'm like, what in the world? And this little Japanese lady, she comes in with her mop and she's just mopping all over, you know, like a dust mop. And I'm sitting there going, man, am I doing something wrong? Did I go in the wrong restroom or what? So, you know, I come out of the bathroom, my pastor, I said, dude, what's going on? He starts laughing, his face is red. He's like, no, that's normal here. The women, you know, they're clean the men's restroom. They don't put like a caution sign to, you know, that's just what they do. And I'm like, gosh, thank God, man. That would have been terrible, you know, if I was in the wrong restroom or something. I didn't know it, but if you go to Japan, they will come in and sweep around you. Just don't mind them. Another funny story, we told the pastor's son. We said, hey, look, check it out, dude. Hope he's not listening online. Please forgive me, Lord. We said the Japanese men freeze their underwear. It's a tradition. They put their underwear in the freezer. The next morning, they get them out, put them on, and that's just what they do. He's like, oh, really? Yeah, dude. You know, and so he was all into the Japanese culture. And, you know, I said, yeah, you know, you should try it. I don't know why they do it, but they. And so he did it, literally. He did it. We showed up to the devotions that morning, and he's like, you know, he can't sit still. That was just a joke. I didn't really do that. Come on, dude. Who does that kind of... Anyway. I don't know where that came from. All right. Sorry about that. Pastor Kevin, please don't fire me. All right. We're in the book of Romans, chapter 4. Now that I completely just lost my train of thought. But anyway, if you want to open up to Romans chapter 4, we're going to look at some verses tonight. Last week, we talked about redemption and justification. We've been talking about that for several weeks. Really, the building blocks, the fundamentals of salvation. What is salvation? It is not just, Jesus, come into my heart, forgive me, I'm a sinner, amen. Right? Picture it as a ladder, okay? This was explained at our meeting on Thursday night, and I thought it was really cool. Salvation is the first step on the ladder or the staircase. Saying the prayer. You say it. That's where it starts, right? You've got to say the prayer. You've got to ask Jesus. But then you keep stepping up the staircase, and there's a process going on. And we've been talking about that process. It's we looked at words like sanctification, right? God has saved us. He set us apart for a specific reason, right? That's what sanctification means, set apart. We're in this world, not of this world. We're set apart, right? And God sent his son Jesus to die on the cross, right? He redeemed us, as my brother was sharing the definition of that earlier. He bought us back, right? We looked at that word propitiation last week. Say that fast three times. Anyways, that definition to that word is important for us to understand. You may not know how to pronounce it, neither do I. But that Christ sacrificed, satisfied God's wrath, right? Making it possible for God to forgive us of our sins. God's justice has been satisfied. That's what that word means. And these are all fundamental things to our salvation. So we have to understand, okay, I'm saved, but what does that mean? So I hope you've been tracking with us. This is a lot of information, biblical stuff in here, knowledge, right? It's not just information, it's to change our lives. We've been talking about how God is more concerned about the condition of my heart than anything else. And so he's been going over that. Paul has been addressing some of these issues that the Jews might have with what Paul is throwing down. You know, they'd say, hey, we're circumcised, we're special. Paul's like, so what? That doesn't save you. Right? Hey, we were born as Jewish men. You know, we were raised up with the law. We were taught under some of the greatest teachers of that time about the law. But Paul says, so what? The law doesn't save you, right? It's faith. It's grace. Ephesians 2, 8, 9. For it is by grace we have been saved through what?
Faith.
Amen. So Paul has been kind of going back and forth in this dialogue in the first few chapters of Romans, and he continues to get deeper into this. Tonight, he's following right along with this whole thing. What is salvation? What did Jesus actually do for us? What does it mean, right? It means he saved us from sin. It means he saved us from hell. I don't know if you realize this tonight, and a lot of you probably do, but if you aren't born again and Jesus comes back, you're going to hell. Or if you reject Christ, and we looked at that, and we also looked at in chapter 2 of Romans, the wrath of God, there has to be God's wrath because he is such a just and holy God, and he paid such a high price for you, for our sins, that he has to cast judgment on those who reject it. I mean, that's just it. Those aren't my words. That's the Bible. This isn't a hellfire and brimstone message. This is gospel truth. The fact that if we don't give our hearts to Jesus and walk out our salvation with fear and trembling, the fact that if we don't do that, if we don't become saved, that we will go to hell, isn't in there to scare the hell out of us. It should be, as Paul was saying, it should draw us closer to Christ and our need for a Savior. It should cultivate in our hearts like, hey, Lord, yes, I got no hope apart from you. I'm a filthy sinner. And because of that, there will be wrath to come if I don't repent and give my life to you, Lord. So there's this picture of God's unconditional love for us in all of this. It's not that God's pointing his finger and saying, if you don't turn and repent, I will burn you. No, he's saying, receive this gift of salvation. I sent my son to die on the cross for you so that you didn't have to pay this wrath. Romans chapter 4, we're going to go through verses 1 through 4 here. But before we do, if you wouldn't mind praying with me. Lord, we just thank you, God, for your goodness tonight, Father. We thank you for your love and your mercy. We thank you for the word of God that transforms our hearts. Tonight, Lord, just change us. Help us to understand these things, Lord. I pray that your spirit would speak in a mighty way. It's in your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. So let's pick it up in the first verse of chapter 4 of Romans. It says, what then shall we say that Abraham our father has found according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. Verse 3, for what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God and was accounted to him for righteousness. Now to him who works, the wages are not counted as grace, but as debt. There seems to be this surprising resistance that I've seen. Maybe you've experienced this as well, about this whole message of justification by faith. I've been challenged in my life by many people who say things to me like this. You mean to tell me that murderer, that rapist, right, the pedophile, okay, that God will forgive them, that Jesus died for that person too. And you mean to tell me that that person, that murderer, that rapist, if he repents, will be in heaven and be forgiven and born again, but the man that's never done any of that stuff, that type of sin, and is a good guy and has raised his family and has took care of his kids and sent them off to college and blah, blah, blah. You mean that guy, that good guy, just because he doesn't receive the Lord is going to hell? Right? The answer to that is yes. You see, Paul is saying it doesn't matter. Justification by faith is not dependent upon anything but what Jesus did for us on the cross. And many people have come to me and say, but how can that be? And I'll tell you tonight, it's very simple. The reason that God designed it that way is because that means it's got nothing to do with us. That means it's got all to do with what he did for us. Because I don't have enough patience for a murderer, for a rapist. I'm just being honest, you know. If it was up to me, see ya, right? But it's not up to me. In fact, it's a waste of my time to sit there and go, man, that guy's sin is so heinous that, whew, man, even God can't save him. God looks at all of us the same. Even that person that's committed those crimes, God looks at him the same as he looks at me. He says, that is my son or daughter. I died. I sent my son to die for that man or that woman. Sometimes we need to refocus our focus on that and know that it's not about us. It's not about what I feel. It's about what the Lord has done for us. Amen. These people from a Jewish background were essentially challenging Paul here in the same way in these scriptures. You know, they're basically saying that, hey, Paul, are you seriously saying that God will forgive these Gentile reprobates who happen to believe on Jesus, right? While their father Abraham, who didn't have Jesus, he was before the cross, he just obeyed the voice of God. He knew the voice of God without the life of Christ, knowing the life of Christ. You mean to tell me, Paul, that he's accepted and we're not, and these Gentile scavenger leftover people? You mean to tell me these Gentile people, just because they believe in you, you know, are saved? And so they're questioning Paul. See, these Jewish people, they don't understand this whole justification by faith, this whole idea, this biblical principle that Abraham believed and it was accounted to him as righteousness. I know there's a lot of us today that probably feel the same way. But anyhow, God called Abraham his friend. Right? Isaiah 41:8 says, but you, Israel, are my servant, Jacob, whom I have chosen, the descendants of Abraham, my friend. Abraham didn't have the full account of the gospel. Jesus, like I said, hadn't been born yet, wasn't crucified and rose from the dead, but he still believed the voice of God. Genesis 26, verses 4 through 5 says, and I will make your descendants multiply as the stars of the heaven. I will give to your descendants all these lands, and in your seed all the nations of the earth shall be blessed. Because Abraham obeyed my voice and kept my charge, my commandments, my statutes, and my laws. Abraham believed through faith, and he was justified. And I like the text goes further on and says, look at, Abraham had lots to boast about, right? I mean, we just read, hey, you're the father of many nations. I mean, woo, you know, imagine God showing up in your house and telling you that. Many nations will be blessed through you, through your faith and your obedience, Abraham. I mean, the guy had every reason in the world to boast. Hey guys, check it out. I'm his favorite. I know you all think you are, but I really am. He's called me and blessed me, and many nations, many millions of people will come to faith and be blessed because of me, right? No. Paul says in our text tonight, he says, absolutely not. In verse 2 there of Romans 4, it says, for if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. Abraham had many things he could have boasted about, but not before God. Why? Because nothing else matters. Abraham simply believed. That's what he did. You and I simply believe. We don't have anything to boast about. It's not, oh man, look how good I've done. In fact, my life, I don't know, maybe yours is the exact opposite. Wow, look how much of a mess I've made. And God still picked me up and set my feet upon a rock. And now he is using me, right? My story is quite the opposite. But some of us think, ooh, look at me. You know, we need another notch in our belt, right? No, it ain't got nothing to do with us. It didn't have anything to do with Abraham's behavior. It had to do with Abraham's belief. We looked at that last week, but Paul continues to elaborate on that in our text tonight. So Abraham had all the reasons in the world to boast, but he did not. Abraham left Ur of the Chaldees, a place of real sophistication and wealth. That wasn't where God declared Abraham righteous. And it wasn't when Abraham took his son Isaac up to Mount Moriah to offer him as a sacrifice. It wasn't even then that God declared Abraham justified, righteous. God declared Abraham righteous when Abraham simply believed. So that begs the question, when is a person saved, right? That's a valid question. I don't know the answer to that. No, I'm kidding. When is a man or woman saved? Not when he follows God and does this sacrificial thing or is completely obedient, but like Abraham, when that person simply believes, yes, Jesus, you died for me. I believe that. Forgive me, Father. I'm a sinner. I need you, Lord. That's when a person's saved. You see, why do I mention that? Because I believe today there's a lot of people walking around that do all these sacrificial things and all these super spiritual things, but in their heart, they're dead. In their heart, they're dead. I was that person. Now, I'm not saying that I wasn't saved. You know, there might be some people out there that aren't saved. I don't know. I'm not the judge of that. But I know where I was years back. I know that I knew the truth. I knew that I knew what Jesus had did for me. I knew what God had called me to do, but I chose to take another path. And it looked like on the outside of my life that things were great, but on the inside I was hurting, bad, lost, confused, really confused for quite a while. Lord, why can't I get this right, man? What the heck is going on here? Why do I keep in this vicious cycle of doing well and then falling and just blowing all these good things that God has done for me, you know, blowing my witness, taking somebody else down with me. Why can't I stop doing this? God said to me, just as he would say to Abraham, Brian, believe, stop doing. It's not about what you do. It's about believing in what I've done for you. Same thing for us. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, as I mentioned earlier, says, for by grace you have been saved through faith. And that not of ourselves, it's the gift of God, right? I love that. Not of works, lest anyone should boast. We don't have anything to boast about. You want to boast? Boast in Jesus. Those of us in this room that know Dave Davis went on to be with the Lord now, but he used to say, now come on, you can brag on Jesus. Brag on Jesus a little bit, right? Yeah, man, he was so cool. I always laughed every time he said that. He's like, it's okay, now come on, brag on Jesus a little bit. You know, but he's right. Brag on what Jesus has done for us. It was a gift. Salvation is a gift. Justification, redemption, propitiation. Those are gifts. Those are all part of the gift that God has given us, which we know is salvation. Moving on in our text tonight, verse 4 of Romans 4 says, now to him who works, the wages are not counted as grace, but as debt. A lot of times we forget and think it's because of our great faith, our massive prayer life, our dedication to whatever it may be, right? Or our devotion to God or whatever, you fill in the blanks, that's why God has blessed us. That is not why God has blessed us. We will see why in just a minute here. In fact, Paul says here that our works are counted as debt. You know, the opposite of grace, counted as debt. And without faith in our life first, We can work all we want, Paul's saying here, but it's counted as debt. Counted against us, in other words. When you're in debt, you owe somebody money, right? If I have debt, I owe some person money. If they lent me money and I didn't pay them back, I have a debt. A little similarity there with what Jesus has done for us. We owed a debt that he paid. Amen. But James 2:26, we get a clear picture here that God is more interested in our hearts than anything else. James 2:26 says, "For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also." In other words, a body without breath is pretty useless, right? A person without the spirit is spiritually dead. Now, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure that out. But James is drawing sort of a connection here between a works-less faith, meaning, you know, a life works without faith first. All we do is work, 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 and do good and do good, right? He's comparing that to a body without breath. What in the world is my body without breath? It's called dead, right? If I can't breathe, I'm probably dying. And James says that is what our lives as believers look like when all we see is all these great works in our life, but no faith, no fruit of the Spirit in our life. It's just all, wow, look how much he's done or look how much she's done. That can be a trap. Try being a leader in ministry. It could be a trap. You know, it could be a trap. We want to work. We want to do good. Sometimes we get kind of confused with, you know, well, wait a minute, but all the stuff I'm doing is good stuff. Well, certainly. I mean, you know, serving in ministry of all different kinds is great, especially if it's glorifying God. But what are the motivations in my heart? Why am I doing it? Am I doing it so that, you know, Pastor Kevin looks over and says, golly, man, look at Brian. Ooh, he is just, look at all the stuff he's doing. He doesn't say that anyway, but no, right? Or am I doing that so my wife says, oh, what a godly man I married. Wow, I'm so in love. She says that anyway, but no. Am I doing it? You know, what's the motivation in my heart? This is what Paul is talking about. This is what James is talking about. And here's the good thing. When we are truly born again, we naturally want to do the things of the Lord. If God has changed our heart, then it's like if you buy a new Mustang, you want to what? Go fast. Probably into a pole, right? You don't buy a hot rod to sit there and go 15 miles an hour on I-5. If you do, you have other problems, right? No, you buy a hot rod that goes fast because you want to get in that thing and get some muscle. You want to feel the burn, whatever you call it. I don't know. Right? You want to go fast. Now, just bear with me here. In California, people buy trucks and raise them up and never go off-road with them. I don't know where that fits in my text, but I don't know. At least here in Oregon, they go off-road in these big old $9 million trucks with tires and lights and all this stuff underneath them, right? But California, they drive them in traffic on the freeways. It's like, dude, if I owned a truck like that, I'm going jumping stumps and ditch bank running or whatever, right? That's what happens when Jesus changes our hearts. God, we want to tell people about it. We want to serve the Lord. We look for opportunities to serve people because maybe they don't know the love of Christ yet, and we want to help them with that, right? I married my wife because I loved her, and she's really good looking. See how I got those right? I loved her, and she's really good looking. I loved her first, okay? I'm being serious. But anyway, no, like you don't marry somebody that you're not in love with. I mean, okay, bad joke, never mind. Moving right along. We all make stupid mistakes, all right? Don't worry about it. You guys get my point. I'm not going to carry on proving my thank you. Yeah. Moving on to Romans chapter 4 and verses 5 through 8. Please don't marry someone if you're not in love with them. All right. Verse 5 says, But to him who does not work but believes on him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is accounted for righteousness. Just as David also described the blessedness of the man to whom God imputes righteousness apart from works, blessed are those whose lawless deeds are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord shall not impute sin. I love this. Paul wasn't satisfied here with explaining Romans, explaining Abraham's faith to us, right? So he's going to bring another heavy hitter of the faith, if you will. David, we're going to look at here in a minute. And David's actually, Paul is actually quoting out of Psalms 32. But before we get there, verse 5, I want to point out that, listen, it's not the one who has faith in his own faith, but it's the person who has faith in the goodness and the provision, right? In the kindness and the grace of the Lord, right? That's the person that the Lord says to, look, you're not trying to earn my favor or earn my blessing. You're just believing in who I am, the justifier of the ungodly. Therefore, because of that, I pronounce you righteous. That's what the Lord is saying in these verses. That's what he's saying through Abraham, through David's testimony, through David's life of faith. In fact, in verses 6 through 8 in our text tonight, Paul is quoting from Psalms 32. And I'll just read it to you. The first two verses of Psalms 32 says, "Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord does not impute iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit." Now, I love this. The word blessed literally means, oh, how happy. Happy is the man that receives this and believes it. Walking with Jesus shouldn't be a drag. We shouldn't be full of negativity and envy and bitterness and strife and deceit, and the list goes on. David and Abraham understood. Listen, they were happy about what truly they discovered that God had done for them. My question to us, are we happy? Are we, oh, how happy are we that God has blessed us and not imputed, right? That word impute means God didn't charge us with what we deserve, what we had coming, in other words. He settled the account through his son Jesus on the cross. He didn't charge us with that. And so David and Paul tonight are saying, oh, how happy is the man, blessed is the man that understands this. What a reason to be happy. Blessed is the man who understands that I don't have to go burn and rot in hell because Jesus paid that price for me. And that's a reason to rejoice and be happy. David says, oh, how happy. I love the fact that the more I study God's word, the more I find his foundational truths all woven together, right? Paul has taken us all the way back to Genesis to look at Abraham and his faith and what that means for us today. We see very clearly in the beginning in Genesis that, you know, Abraham believed and it was accounted to him as righteousness. And we see now in the book of Romans, which is way later, it's on the other side of the cross, right? We see that Paul is saying, hey, from the very beginning, this was God's plan of salvation. All right. Somebody's phone's going off. Blessed is the man who understands these things tonight. Romans 4, 9 through 12 says, "Does this blessedness then come from the uncircumcised only or upon the uncircumcised also? For we say that faith was accounted to Abraham for righteousness. How then was it accounted? While he was circumcised or uncircumcised? While circumcised, not while circumcised, but while uncircumcised. And he received the sign of circumcision, a seal of the righteousness of the faith which he had while still uncircumcised, that he might be the father of all those who believe, though they are uncircumcised. Wow. That righteousness might be imputed to them also. And the father of circumcision to those who not only are of the circumcision, but who also walk in the steps of the faith which our father Abraham had while still uncircumcised. All I know about those verses is that's a lot of circumcision. Right? Amen. Paul really drives this point home in these verses. He has just used Abraham and David as examples of men who had been justified apart from works. But there's one problem with these two examples. Both of them were Jews. What about the Gentiles, right? Remember, Paul wrote the letter of Romans mostly to the Gentile believers there in Rome. Verse 10 and 11, how then was it accounted? While he was circumcised or uncircumcised? Not while circumcised, but while uncircumcised. Paul here is saying, apart from all the circumcision going on, that Abraham is the father not only of the circumcised Jew, but of the uncircumcised Gentile, right? Because Abraham was pronounced righteous long before he was circumcised. That's what that scripture's saying. Now you may say, well, what does that even mean? Well, it means a lot. It means that the very act of circumcision doesn't make anybody righteous. It didn't make anybody in the Old Testament in Abraham's day righteous. It only confirmed the righteousness that they had already had in Christ. Just like baptism. We don't get baptized. Sorry, I got hair in my nose. We don't get baptized to become saved, right? Sorry. We don't get baptized to become saved. We get saved first. And then we know, we go, baptism, all it is a public expression of saying, hey, I'm a believer. I bear witness to what Jesus has done for me. Going under the water and coming back up is just symbolic of Jesus' death. That's it. But if you're not born again first, before that happens, all you did was got wet in a bathtub. Some dude dunked you and came up. It don't mean nothing, right? The same thing with communion. We don't take communion until we're believers. In fact, Paul warns us in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, don't do this if you're not saved. It might actually harm you. But what is communion? Communion is a symbol. It represents the body and the blood. It says in the Word of God, do this in remembrance of me. We do this in remembrance of what Jesus has done for us after we're born again. All it is saying, hey, I take this juice, I take this cracker. Lord, I identify with your broken body. I'm grateful for that. And I take this cup. Lord, you shed your blood for me on Calvary. Thank you. We do this in remembrance of you. But that doesn't save us, right? Paul is saying that circumcision, you Jewish people, you need to get with the program, Paul is saying. It's about faith in Christ, period. That's where this all begins. If I could communicate one thing to you tonight, it's this. We really need to try to give, to stop trying to give God a reason to bless us. That'll never work because God will be a debtor to no man. Instead of working so that God blesses me, well, I got to do this. I got to do this. I got to go through this class. I got to go through U-turn. I got to go through this course at church. I have to do all these things because God will bless my family. That is wrong theology. In other words, it's I'm going to do this because Jesus changed my heart. He did not impute sin upon me or wrath. He paid the price for me. So, Lord, I want to serve you. I want to do these things. Because as David said in Psalms 32, oh, how happy is the man that understands this. Oh, how happy should we be tonight when we understand what God has done. Quit trying to work so hard if that's you. Quit trying to get another notch in your belt. God is saying through his word, through Abraham, through David, through Paul, just believe. That belief produces action on its own within us. Tonight, friends, we have, those of us that are saved, we have full access. Trip out on this. We got VIP seats, backstage passes, right, to the throne room of God. We have access to the full work, completed work of Jesus on the cross. Man, think about that for a minute. We're not like Abraham and David on the other side of the cross where we don't have that yet. Man, we're on this side of the cross. They were on this side of the cross, right? You didn't know I had a prop up here, huh? That's all right. Neither did I. I forgot. We're on this side of the cross. The completed work of the cross. Those of us that are saved. Just to wrap up a few minutes here, I want to share some things with you. While Jesus was on the cross, look at what he did. Look at what he said. John chapter 19 and verse 28 through 30. It says, after this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, said, I thirst. Now a vessel full of sour wine was sitting there, and they filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on hyssop, and put it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, it is finished. And bowing his head, he gave up his spirit. Well, what does that mean for us? Have you ever read that and just kept reading because it really didn't make sense? Well, Paul has been explaining in the last four chapters of Romans what that means for us. I want to share a few things tonight with you about what that means for us. We have fullness and abundance of Christ, grace, favor, and every spiritual blessing because of Jesus' death on the cross. John 1:16 says, and of his fullness we have all received, and grace for grace. We have a new identity and a new spirit in Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places have been poured out upon us. Ephesians 1, verse 3 says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. He's given us a spirit of power, love, and a discipline, a sound mind, and self-control. 2 Timothy 1:7 says, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of a sound mind. Love and of a sound mind, excuse me. He's given us his mind, the mind of Christ, his thoughts, his feelings, his purposes, right? 1 Corinthians 2:16 says, for who has known the mind of the Lord that they may instruct him, but we have the mind of Christ. And lastly, we've got God's DNA. His love is in us. We are God's children, and we grow in our understanding of him because of that love in us. 1 John 4:6-8 says, we are of God. He who knows God hears us. He who is not of God does not hear us. By this we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know love, for God is love. We could continue to go on and on about all the benefits that the cross, Jesus' death on the cross, and what it's done for us as children of God. Those are just a few I wanted to point out to you tonight. There's many more, and I found this really cool statement. I did not make this up, but I thought it was cool. It's salvation. The Father thought it, the Son bought it, the Spirit taught it, the Bible brought it. Satan fought it, but praise the Lord, by His grace, we got it. I love that, man. That is so cool. So tonight, if you don't know what you have in Christ Jesus, if you don't know what salvation means, I pray that some of these things would struck a chord in your heart, that you would go back and say, Lord, what do these things mean? What does it mean to be redeemed, Lord? What does it mean to be sanctified, to be regenerated, to be redeemed, to be renewed, right? I pray that you would understand through the book of Romans, through the Holy Spirit's teaching, what those things mean, because it's the very fundamentals of our salvation. It's what it means to be saved. And the more I know what it means to be saved and walk my life according to that, the more I can share that with you and the next person that may not know, or the next person that asks me a question. The Bible says, be ready in season and out of season, right? Be ready to give a response to the hope that lies within us, the Word also says. So let's pray. If you will, Father, we love you. I pray if there's anybody here tonight, Lord, that's not saved, they would just come up and pray. Just ask for prayer. Ask to be led in that prayer, that they would find somebody before they leave this building. If it's online, Lord, that they would come in to the church office or call in, Lord, or get a hold of somebody and say, I want to know you, Jesus. I want to know what you did for me. I want to understand what salvation is in my life. How it's changed me, changed my heart. We love you. We thank you, God, for what you've done for us. Bless the rest of this evening. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.